You're about to watch one of the most influential thinkers of the 21st century, the man who virtually founded the personal development and self-help industry, and in the process, transformed our understanding of the human mind. His name is Richard Bandler. As the co-creator of neuro-linguistic programming, or NLP, he's improved the lives of millions across the world through his seminars and self-help products. His works have been translated into over 20 languages, and his books, CDs, and DVDs regularly top the self-help charts.
NLP is about getting the best procedure from the people who have succeeded the best at any task and teaching other people to do it. It's about having lessons that tell you how to design the inside of your head just like you would design the inside of a room.
Dr. Bandler personally trained to NLP Master Trainer level the internationally acclaimed lifestyle guru Paul McKenna. And motivational powerhouse Anthony Robbins freely acknowledges that NLP has influenced his own work.
I think the tools I've created are evolutionary in nature. We've never had a way to think about how we think. Being trained primarily as a physicist taught me to think in terms of how things work in systems. I used to design compiler systems, and that technology of teaching machines to do what humans did got me the idea that we could teach humans to do what other humans did by looking at the process, not the content.
Thanks to Dr. Bandler's mind training techniques, therapists, athletes, business people, writers, artists, musicians, teachers, entrepreneurs, negotiators, politicians, and countless others have become more successful and more effective at what they do. NLP has even inspired and been featured in TV hit series. Through NLP, millions have become assured and more self-confident, fostering a positive outlook on life that's freed them to achieve their goals and fulfill their ambitions. And because Richard Bandler teaches others the art and science of excellence, celebrities who excel at what they do are happy to work alongside him.
What I do is I teach people to think differently. You think differently, you feel differently, therefore what you can do expands.
Whether you want to become a master in communication, reach the pinnacle in your powers of persuasion with techniques that will leave everyone winners, or simply overcome a phobia and gain more confidence, watch now and understand how you can change your life forever with Richard Bandler and NLP. Neuro-linguistic programming has proved a successful technique to turn around people's lives in a positive way. One area where it has shown astonishing results is in dealing with phobias.
A phobia is an overwhelmingly intense feeling response. Typically, it's one step beyond anxiety, where objects or the thought of the objects prevent people from being able to function. People become immobilized. People can't get in elevators. People can't fly. People get in an airplane and they're afraid. They have anxiety. People who can't get in the airplane are afraid. The people today that I'll use are people that can't do things, and they'll be able to do them.
I have claustrophobia.
My phobia is snakes. I really, really don't like spiders.
I can have a whole evening ruined by seeing a spider, as if someone had come in to mug me or something. You know, the heartbeat. And I don't want that anymore.
Today, the co-founder of NLP, Richard Bandler, is holding a seminar for people with all sorts of phobias. Some of these have been paralyzed with fear all of their lives. But now, all of that is about to change.
To cure my phobia, I think it would make me feel like relief because I don't have to think about it in a negative way anymore.
Good morning. Guess what today is? Phobia Day. Which is badly named. It's not a day to acquire phobias, but if you want one, I could probably do that too. You see, when part of the reason I like to have this day where we do things is to me, part of NLP is about strategies, and some strategies are about motivating yourself, and some strategies are about making decisions. And to me, part of the reason I focused on phobias was to convince psychologists and psychiatrists that people could change quickly. But the other thing is that I like to use it for what I think is more important than the repair part. See, therapists, when they come to my class, are looking for a better way to repair people. When they learn to cure a phobia, they go back and they cure as many phobias as they can. But they miss the big picture, and I don't want you guys to. The big picture is the question. For example, I know some of you have phobias in here. I know some of you went upstairs and they filmed you being nervous about it. Some of you were freaking out because you thought the snakes were going to be upstairs, right? And they hadn't even gotten here yet. The snakes were on the tube riding here, you know, and the snake was going, oh God, another day of 100 people staring at me. I just don't know if I can take it anymore, you know. And meanwhile, you're upstairs freaking out. And here's the cool thing. How many of you went upstairs and freaked out because there was a snake, or didn't go upstairs because there might be a snake? Even worse, raise your hands. How many of you? Right? Guess what? You were freaking out and the snakes weren't here. Now this means something important. Your fear has nothing to do with snakes. Right? Because you could do it without snakes. It's not snakes, it's the idea of snakes. Neurolinguistic programming is the name that I gave to all the techniques I developed, which were really studying successful behaviors. Rather than studying people with fears to find out how they got them, I found people who had gotten over them quickly, learned what they did mentally to learn the formulas by which you think your way out of problems.
I just get really anxious. Fear, it's fear. I had really bad panic attacks. I know if I can get rid of my fear of spiders, I could conquer anything else.
Just sit down if you would. That's a really important part of the human experience when you get to the point where you become intolerant of your inability to do something. Every great musician I've ever interviewed, every great artist tells me, they go, well, you know, I was really stuck doing the same kind of thing and I just went, I can do better than this. And they get this thing where I'm not going to get stuck in this rut, I'm going to improve. See, if you were running a school to teach people to be afraid of spiders, okay, and you were the world's expert on this, what would you have to teach them to do inside their head? See, all I had to do is ask about upstairs, and you made certain pictures, talked to yourself in a certain tone of voice, and then created...
When you did that,
I'm very good at it,
too. Yeah, that was send the shiver, right down.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So, yeah, but before you got the shiver, what did you do to get the shiver?
I thought of a spider.
Okay,
you thought of it. I had to think of it, yeah.
Okay, and where's the picture of the spider? In your head, point to it with your finger. It's right there.
In front, yeah.
Okay, how big is the spider in the picture, by the way?
Big plate size, sort of.
Plate size spider. Okay.
Big one with long legs.
Okay, so you have a spider this big and this close.
Well, a little further away because I won't get that close. Do you know, even
it's just a fucking picture in your head. You're the one making it. You pointed and said the picture was right here and that the spider was that big.
But it's further.
Okay, so it's a little further away, but it's pretty big. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So what we're going to do is we're going to take one of those memories. Mm-hmm. Can you think of one time you saw a spider and you were afraid?
Yes.
Okay. Now, what I want you to do, so I want you to close your eyes and I want you to look at that memory, right? And what I want you to do is I want you to float out of the memory so that you can see yourself there being afraid. I want you to look at yourself squirting up your face and shivering in your boots. And I want you to look at that picture and realize you could do that 20,000 times in the next 10 years. And I want you to look at yourself and see, as you look at yourself that terrified, do you want to be that person?
No.
In fact, when you look at her, isn't it kind of annoying and disgusting? Right? Mm-hmm. So look at her looking at the spider, and then what I want you to do is to float out of your body here in the chair and look at yourself sitting here pissed off, looking at yourself over there terrified. Mm-hmm. Now, I want you to sit there calmly, and I want you to run the whole memory forward so that you see yourself jumping around, being afraid of the spider, sitting here, being disgusted, looking at yourself, being afraid of the spider. Mm-hmm. And I want you to kind of sit in the balcony and watch the two of you calmly as you go through this memory. Mm-hmm. Now, once you get to the end, I want you to slip now back into your body, right? And then what we're going to do is we're going to jump to the end of the memory. Mm-hmm. Okay? And I want you to step inside the memory, and I want you to run it backwards so that the spider moves backwards. Until the spider is gone.
Yep.
Now, oddly enough, these two mental shifts in perception, right? Because here's the trick to the whole thing. While you were sitting there disgusted at Lydia being afraid of the spiders, you were looking at a spider without being afraid. Step one. Mm-hmm. See? Because as soon as you change your point of view, your brain begins to recode. Now, what I want you to do is I want you to open your eyes and look at my finger, okay? Mm-hmm. Just look at my finger. Okay, I'm going to bring it around here. Turn your head a little bit. It's okay. Turn your head. Look at me. Because, you see, I want the learning and the understandings about spiders, which is going to generalize to everything. You've already now looked at an image that scared you before, mm-hmm. and it didn't scare you.
Right.
Okay. Now, this means your brain is about ready to learn something. And as long as you're looking at that finger, your peripheral vision, that's right, is just about ready to go sleep. And I want you to go inside, and I want you to feel good. Now, you remember that tingling that went up your arms, mm-hmm. right? What we're going to do is I notice which way you moved your fingers, because it started in one place on your arm and moved to the other place. And I want you to start at the end of that feeling, and I want you to feel it move in the opposite direction. And literally take your feelings, the way you were frightened, and run them in reverse. Because when you spin feelings that are scared in an opposite direction, what happens is you get the opposite feeling. You got it spinning? Mm-hmm. Okay, now spin it faster, and spin it faster, and spin it faster still. Now, I want you to keep that feeling spinning, and I want you to open your eyes, because you and I are going to talk, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, what if I told you there was a big spider the size of my hand, and it was going to come in the room?
Sort of okay.
Sort of okay. All right. Tina! Oh, Tina!
I'm going to put my glasses on. I need them for distance. Or should I leave them off?
Okay. Also, Tina's in a box, but okay. That's just for now. Okay. Take a deep breath. Now, remember, you have to look, okay, and you have to look. Does what you see scare you?
Yeah, I can feel.
Okay. Now, close your eyes, right? Notice which way the fear is spinning. Is it tumbling forward? It's falling back. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, spin it a little faster so you get a little more scared. Okay. And then slow it down and spin it in the opposite direction and keep your eye on the prize. Do you want to be a self-confident person who can do what they want in life?
Yes.
Right? And then remember, when you looked at a memory and stepped outside of it and saw yourself being afraid, you didn't like it.
Mm-mm.
Right? Keep that feeling around, and then open your eyes, right? Look over at Tina. Take your hand, bring it just close enough, right? And keep the feeling spinning in the new direction. Right? A little bit closer, right? Okay. One hand up, a little bit closer. That stop there. Okay, now when you look at it, all right. You got to keep breathing. Otherwise, okay. Anxiety functions mm-hmm. by holding your breath. So breathe in through your mouth, slowly out through your nose, right? Spin it in the new direction and keep it spinning. That's right. Spin it faster in the new direction. That's right. And relax. It's in a plastic fucking box, right? And then float out of yourself. Close your eyes for a minute. Float out of yourself. Look at yourself being afraid and say to yourself, this is fucking stupid. I'm sick of this, okay. Right? Then float back in. Open your eyes. Signal her a little closer. Good.
Okay.
Right? Now, look at the little furs on there. She's going, please let me out of the box, please. I hate it in here. Right?
Okay.
Okay. Now, let me just ask you, just right now, let me just ask you a question. My guess is 15 minutes ago, you would have never thought you could do this.
No.
Right? Are you proud of yourself?
Yes.
You should be.
I am.
I just want you to have a nice, good look and look really close. Take a deep breath, and, right? Put your finger up there. Don't you want to be the girl that can put her finger up there? Cool, huh? Now, you're doing something you didn't believe you could do.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You're doing something that outside of the world. So close your eyes and think for a moment inside what this means about you and the entire rest of your life. If you walk into a room and there's a spider on the wall, you don't have to freak out ever again.
Also, if there's anything in your life that you think is impossible, you'll go, I was wrong about myself once. Mm-hmm. I can be wrong this time. So I tell you what, take a deep breath and smile and take a long look at what Tina did for you. She's cute, isn't she?
At least she's still. That's kind of good, you know.
Well, that's because we haven't opened the box yet.
Ah, the air. Okay. Yeah.
Well, she's got air. We're not. See, it has holes in the top. We're not going to try and kill Tina.
There she goes.
Yeah.
It's a she.
Richard, you're making me crazy, baby. There you go.
Even the idea that there might be a spider was more than she could bear, let alone. So the idea that she could put her finger right next to one and be calm was incomprehensible.
Now, Carolyn, would you come up here and sit next to her?
Because I believe in osmosis, by the way. Right, okay. Did you, Carolyn, did you believe that Lydia would put her finger on a spider?
Yeah.
You did? Okay, well, that's good. How about you touching a snake? Because I tell you what, Lydia, I want you to look at my hand and sleep. That's right, go inside. Because I want you to take a deep breath and I want you to go deep, deep, just relax and go inside. I want you to fall into a deep, deep, deep trance because I want you to solidify the learnings, the understandings. So you go into a deep, comfortable state because I want to talk to Carolyn. You see, Carolyn, this is the way it works. This seminar is about making changes in your life and also knowing that everybody can. Now, you believe that she could, but the idea for yourself seems more difficult, of course, right? Oh, okay.
If I saw a snake in the room now, I would be really scared and anxious, and I'll feel like probably I would pass out. Yeah, if I could touch a snake or get close to it, I think it would make me feel like relief. I'll probably be able to go on holiday to places where I didn't think of it before.
Sleep. Now, because what I want you to do is to go inside, and I want you to take a look at yourself being afraid for the last time. I want you to see yourself with your pictures of snakes being terrified, and I want you to look at yourself being afraid, and I want you to make the picture big, and I want you to see yourself being nervous and being scared until you look at yourself and you think to yourself, enough is enough. I shouldn't be that nervous of this. It shouldn't scare me that much. It's not like some venomous python that's going to get me. We're not in a dangerous situation. You were scared just from a picture of a snake. You were scared from an idea of a snake. And actually, they're quite lovely, you know, because we have a beautiful snake here, a big, giant, beautiful snake, you see? And if you keep looking at yourself being afraid, while you're looking at yourself, your brain is already changing. Because when you look at yourself being afraid and you think, I'm tired of this, I want the prize that's at the other end of the line. I want the prize that says, if I can do this, I can do anything. Because it means that you can take control of your internal processes. So Carolyn, go and find a memory where you were afraid of a snake. Whether it was there or not doesn't matter. The memory is there. Float out of the memory and watch yourself being afraid. And say to yourself, that's just fucking stupid. I'm tired of this. Just fucking fed up. Because they always say you're going to look back and laugh. My policy is why wait? Because if you don't wait, Carolyn, if you start laughing now, and I do want you to laugh a little bit more, even more. Come on, bigger laugh, a little giggling, that kind of giggling. Now, while you're laughing at this, take that feeling of laughter and start to spin it in your body faster and faster and tell yourself, I can do this, right? Because if you stop and instead make a picture where you see yourself looking at a big snake, not being afraid. Now, if you see what you'd look like if you weren't afraid, the question is, do you want to be that girl, the one that's strong? You have to look at that picture and yearn for it because you're not there yet. I want you to look at the picture and go, I want to be her. I want to be the one that's not afraid. I want to be the one that can do things. I want to be the girl with personal power. Because you see, if you look at that image and you're drawn towards that image and you desire that image, it tells your unconscious to begin to change you right now. And what happens is you go through and you take that memory of being afraid, you start at the end, you run it backwards, and you giggle at it.
That's right. And you giggle a little bit more and you spin the new feeling and you realize Richard's about to bring a big snake in here. Only difference is, by the time it gets close enough to you to touch, you'll be the most powerful girl you ever thought you could be times 10. Because you see, you don't know how strong you can be. You have no idea as a human being, Carolyn, how powerful you can be. Because you have ideas that are in your head. Now, once you start cleaning out the old pictures, laughing at them, we might say, giggling at them, smirking at them, going, ha, 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 never again. Just like the guy, never again will you fool me. Never again is this gonna be here. When you look at yourself and say never again, what happens is you're gonna take control. Now in a moment, I'm gonna reach over and I want you to take that laughing state, and when you open your eyes, I want you to start giggling. One, two, three, open your eyes. Okay. Snakes, please. Again, the snake's not gonna come any closer than you want it to. But you see, you have to be curious. Just stop for a second if you would. Now, what I want you to do is to first take the feelings, right? How do you feel now? Are you scared?
Just wanna get done with it.
Okay. Right, okay, but, so you feel determined?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Take the determination, spin it, pull up your hand and tell them to come as close as you want. Oh, okay, a little bit more. Okay, that's good. Now look at the pretty colors in the scales. Can you see them clearly? Okay, now what I want you to figure out is how close you can get, because I want you to be able to reach out, touch that snake. So take a deep breath, come a little bit closer, and look at it real carefully. First you have to look at something, right? You have to look at the skin, look at where it is. Take a deep breath, spin your feelings in the opposite direction, open your eyes, and reach your hand down.
I want to do it underneath because it scared me the most, really.
I beg your pardon?
I want to touch the white stuff there.
Okay.
It's pretty ugly.
Okay. Now you want to touch the white stuff. She's a belly rubber. Cool, huh? Right. But you don't have to do this every day. It's not like you don't have to take his job. He likes this. Freud would have something to say about that.
Yeah.
Okay, close your eyes. That's all right, you can go. Close your eyes and go inside and realize both Carolyn and Lydia have now done something that 10 minutes ago they said was impossible.
Richard really helped me to control the bad feeling and actually just get like sort of a neutral feeling about snakes or phobia of snakes. It was just not affecting me at all anymore.
The point of this is real simple, to go inside your brain now and to realize if you could face this fear so easily and so quickly, you can face all the rest of them this way. Because, you know, how many times are you going to encounter a snake in life or a magazine picture of a snake? Not that many. But there are bigger things in life you have to face. And if you can shift your brain like this so quickly, what this means is you can shift your brain about anything. So I want you two girls to think about what's more important. What haven't you faced in your life? What haven't you believed in yourself enough? Because the one thing you should build out of this is a belief that you can do things that you didn't think were possible. So therefore, you haven't been thinking about them. You haven't been thinking about how much you can accomplish in life, how deeply you can lay in love, how good you can make kisses, all the things in life that make it worthwhile. See, I know people that go, oh, I can't do this, I can't do this, so they never try. They never play music, they never draw, they don't write poetry, they don't write books. They don't do anything with abandonment, and most of them don't even try to do it at all. And if they do try, they do it just a little bit, and they go, oh, I'm not perfect at it. Excuse me, Mozart didn't start out perfect at piano. The first time he played scales, he must have had problems too. Now, maybe by the time he was 12, he was a genius, but he didn't do a lot else either. The truth is if you do things with passion, then you'll get passionate results. So I want both of you to go inside your mind and think of what you're going to be more passionate about trying. right now, and I want you to smile while you do it, Lydia. Smiling is really an important part of the process. When you connect big, shiny smiles with things, what happens is you become attracted to them. And once you discover you can do things you didn't think you can do, what it means is you should start doing things that are more worthwhile. So I want you both to take a deep breath, really deep breath, hold it for a second, and when you let it out, I'm going to count one, and I want you to wake up on three, two, eyes open, and this will only stay with you for the rest of your life.
People become happier, they become more functional, they become more successful. What more could you ask from a seminar? So your choice is to go to therapy and whine about it for years, sit home and live in it for years, or do something about it.
I remember having to get in the back, it was about 15 years ago, in the back of someone's car because there was, you know, four of us and I had to get in the back. And I got in the back and they put the seat down and I literally rammed the seat, you know, completely forward and said, get me out of this car, get me out of this car. Went into a blind panic, but it's actually got progressively worse as I've got older. Not being able to breathe, clammy hands, just like real sort of shortness of breath, and then my head starts to sort of literally spin with all the possible eventualities of what could go wrong.
So you have a life-size picture of this closet door closing in your face.
Yeah.
Right, and okay, and as the closet door closes, you don't go inside your head and say, oh, I'll be safe here in the dark where no one can see me. So as the door is closed, you say something about, I have to get out of here or something.
Yeah, I can't breathe.
And, oh, you say, I have to get out of here, I can't breathe.
Yeah.
And you, of course, say this in calm, serene tonality.
No.
You don't?
No.
Okay, what kind of tonality do you use? Like freaky,
like now,
scared,
feel, yeah,
Stephen King type tonality?
Just really nervous.
So you go, ah, I have to get out of here, just to keep yourself calm, of course, right? Okay, let me ask you this, Cura. Does this sound intelligent to you?
No.
Okay, all right, let's try a little experiment, if we would. Okay, just could you turn your chair a little bit towards me, just so it faces me a little bit? Okay, we're just going to play a little game, okay? This is the one where you look me in the eye and try to stay conscious. Okay, hold your hand up like that if you would. Okay, and all I'm going to do is look you in the eye and I'm going to go like this. And slowly I'm going to go into a relaxed state. Here we go. That's it. There we go. That's right. Now, what happens is when you go into an altered state like this, because I'm good and you just followed me in, it's nice to know you'll follow me places, because I'd like to take you down the trail of having a little bit of sense of humor. So we're going to watch a movie of Cura in the closet. I want you to see Cura in the closet being fucking terrified, playing scary pictures of doors closing on her, right? Playing voices, screaming scary things to her. You could even put in scary music, violins. And feelings rushing up her body, but I want you to see herself doing it. I don't want you to do it. I want you to watch yourself doing it. And it has to be on the outside. Look at yourself doing this. Take a deep breath in. Put the picture on the outside. I want you to sit here calmly next to me. Watch her be afraid until it looks silly. You know what silly is, don't you? Okay, I don't want you to step inside the picture. I want you to watch the picture. Just freeze frame it for a minute, right? Freeze frame the picture, float up out of the side so you're in the balcony, watching Cura here with me, watching the picture over there being afraid so that you can stay calm. I want you to be removed. I want you to have a sense of humor. I want you to watch this girl that's been terrified for years, suffering, and I want you to take a deep breath in and say, isn't that kind of silly that she would do that? But you have to keep breathing, otherwise you fall back in the picture. See, and if you jumped off the balcony of a movie into the movie, it wouldn't be any fun. That's why we pay the ticket and stay in our seats, okay? Stay in your seat while the movie is playing. That's the stuff. Little breathing, staying calm, right? And then you have to remember, you have seen things that are silly in your life, haven't you? You've laughed at yourself, haven't you?
Now look at Kira over there with internal screaming voices and realize that if she had Sylvester the cat's voice saying the same thing, she wouldn't be afraid. Thufferin', fuckatat, the Dorth clothing. It suddenly feels different, doesn't it?
So I do a lot of things where I induce in people states where they laugh because it releases oxytocin in the brain, which is the neurochemistry that allows us to recode and change. So I use a lot of humor in my work because it helps people to think differently. It's hard to be upset while you're laughing at yourself.
Now, if you said to yourself, I can open that door and go outside, thufferin' thuckatash, the door closed, so what? I don't give a fuck anymore. If your internal dialogue was pleasant, then you get to be the smiling Kira I'm seeing now. So I want you to look at Kira over there in the first picture, shaking in her boots, and I want you to think to yourself, this is fucking crazy. Enough is enough. Thufferin' fuckatash, it's time you stopped it. Listen inside your head. You can talk with Sylvester's little cat's voice now, can't you? Mm-hmm. You could see the doors closing. Only if you're going to see doors closing. See ones with door handles. In fact, you could see until the door closed, let it go totally dark, and you can imagine where the handle is. Mm-hmm. That's how people walk around when the lights are out. Blind people do it every day, all day long. And they don't even freak out. Because if you have a voice inside your head that says it really doesn't fucking matter, because you could come out of this trance and walk out of this room. If we were sitting here in a small closet, you could open the door and walk outside. It really doesn't fucking matter. What matters is what it means about you as a person. Now, I want you to make a picture of yourself walking into a closet, closing the door for a few minutes, and opening the door and walking out. Would you want to be that girl? Absolutely, because that girl could do anything. That girl could be anything she wanted to be. She could learn anything she wanted to do. Because you can start to do things with abandonment when you take control. When you take what seems like a worst fear and turn it into nothing. When you realize all you need to do that is the voice of Sylvester the cat. It all seems simpler somehow. Suffering thuckatash, why didn't I think of that? Now, when you look at this girl that you want to be, I want you to make that picture life size. Right? And then what I want you to do is I want you to pull the picture close enough so that you can feel her up against you. And when you feel her up against you, I want you to see two doors behind her closing. And I want you to feel her come inside you. Because, you see, you've been in the closet all along. You're actually a strong, assertive person. But you didn't let it come out. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to take a little walk. Excuse us if you people would move your legs here. We're going to take a little walk. We're going to go over here. You're going to take a deep breath. Okay. And we're going to put you in control of your own fears. Ooh, it's a little closet full of stuff. Okay. Now, I want you to take a deep breath. I want you to walk in, close the door for a minute. Take a deep breath, talk to you in Sylvester the cat's voice, and then open the door and walk out. Is that right?
Yeah. I thought I saw a pretty cat.
You forgot the last instruction.
What's that?
To come out.
Oh, yeah.
It was an emotional experience because I think there's a lot of layers underneath that it kind of all were brought into that room and actually all disappeared all at the same time. That's why it was so powerful because, you know, I felt that it wasn't, again, just the claustrophobia. It was other aspects of my life where I get kind of stuck in that feeling of panic and I can't move forward. And it's just made me realise that I can do anything, really.
You see, the brain is designed to make things familiar. She made it familiar to be afraid of small places. You made it familiar to be afraid of spiders. You didn't even need the spiders, just the thought of a spider was enough. Snakes, all the same things. When you run an old scared memory backwards, it flattens out the neurons, because be it ever so microscopic, those neurocortical pathways know how to go to the right one by size. Billions of them woven together, and that one fear one fires off because it goes up by size from a chemical charge. You run the memory backwards, it flattens it out. Then all you need to do is to replace it. Because here's the trick to personal change. You create a void and fill it with something better, then it doesn't go back to what it was. In fact, it begins to generalize. First, it'll be closets you'll stand in. The next thing you know, first it'll be the top of the snake, then it has to be the bottom. Because your brain automatically goes, what's next? And it begins to find out what this learning is supposed to go with. Oh, it goes with elevators, it goes with this, it goes with dressing rooms and in shops. And, you know, you start to add on all the other places where your new longing, so you look in and you go, I'm a new person here. I'm a new person in the elevator. I'm a new person here. So you don't get to just be proud of what you did, you get proud of who you're becoming. All three of these people believed that never could they do something. In fact, they didn't even consider being able to do it. But what's important is to know that you're wrong about yourself, that when you think that you're not the kind of person that could be happy, you're not the kind of person that could be in love, you're not the kind of person that could be creative, you're not the kind of person that could be successful, you're not the kind of person that could have a good marriage, you're not going to be a good mother. The list goes on and on and on. But the minute you do one thing that proves you're dead wrong about yourself, not only does she not have to be afraid of spiders, she can consider all these other possibilities.
With the seminar over, it's time for the delegates to put the NLP techniques Richard has taught them into practice.
I think I'm just amazed, because I think if you're going to hold a spider, hold a big one.
Mm-hmm. Happy enough to see you. I'll move her on then.
Because if it wasn't comfortable, would it move off?
Oh, yeah, very much so. Yeah.
So she likes me.
Yeah. There you go.
She likes you.
Job done.
Wow. I'm free to go improve and live my life now.
I don't cure anybody because I don't think they're sick. Somebody learned to be afraid. It just means they're dependable. All I have to do is get them to be dependable in a new way. I'm a teacher. This is all about education. This is about learning to use your neurology so that you can consciously and unconsciously do what you want to do. Somebody comes to a practitioner seminar. What they do is they learn to have control of their thought processes. You change the way you think. It changes the way you feel, changes what you can do. And I've been at this for 40 years, and I've watched people change their lives in ways most people would never believe.
You can put it around. It's okay.
Put it
right
yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Let's do it.
Wow.
Oh, boy. Okay. Anytime I'll be around something that really, really scares me, I know I can do it because I proved myself today I could actually do it, so. It's fine. Nothing to be afraid of anymore.
Fantastic. I'd absolutely, I'd just be so happy if I can get over my fear of spiders. But the thought of even getting near one is kind of quite kind of scary.
There we go. Hand nice and still.
I don't know if cute's the right word.
I think it is.
Sorry, Tina, my hands are very cold.
Just move her on.
So I held her in my hand and she's very light and I wasn't scared at all and I moved her to the other hand and I just didn't mind and I kind of just wanted to sit there and just play a bit more and let her just keep moving along.
Phobics are extremely dependable. Elevator doors open, heart races, right? Which means once they learn something, they're really good at it. So all I have to do is teach them instead to go after their desires rather than going away from their fears.
A phobia is public speaking, and I can't remember when it started. I've had it ever since I can remember. If you were to ask me to go up to the stage, I would sit there and an overwhelming feeling of burning just takes hold of me. So I get like this whole fireball around here, and I just feel frozen to the spot. There's absolutely no power in me to be able to get up and do it. I believe that to walk out of here today and to be able to stand up in front of a crowd will make me realise that anything is possible.
Hello everyone, my name is Adele Sinclair and I'm a product designer.
Fantastic.
Okay, tell them where you're from.
I'm from Manchester. Feels absolutely fantastic.
Fantastic, give her a round of applause.
I feel now that facing your fears is actually quite a fantastic thing to do. You know, that's the only way you'll ever make yourself a better person. And it makes you feel like once you've started to tackle one, it's just more experience, more experience, more experience, and it's reprogramming what you're already thinking. So yeah, that's what I want to do. I just want to experience it more and push my boundaries more and step out of my safety zone to try and make myself a better person than I am.
Now, once you learn to be afraid, you need to put something in front of that fear, desire. The fear is still there. They still could be afraid. They just won't do it. And once you give people choices, they'll use them. But if there's no choice, they'll only react. And to me, the thing that makes it so it will stay with them for the rest of their life, I like the hypnotic suggestion, never hurts either, but to me, the reason I tell people that is so that they understand that this is a beginning, not an end. It's not that we're done, now you can go around touching snakes. It's now you have to ask the big question. What else, what other crap can I get out of my mind so that I could get on to what I want to do? You know, if somebody has a horrible bad memory and they think about it, and you know, 20 minutes five times a day, it's an hour, 7 days a week, you know, 52 weeks in a year, times 10 is 520 weeks. It's, you know, you're talking tens of thousands of hours that people are going to spend huddering around, making images, having a bad feeling. When you free up all that time and they start to think about their desires, then people can really change and get a lot done, live good lives, have more fun. And they start asking the question, how good can things be, rather than how can I get out of this?